So, very, very warm welcome to all of you who have come here for the National Symposium on Strabismus and Neuro-Ophthalmology. I mean, this subject is something which is going to be more interesting in future, as you will see. Times are changing, a lot of things have changed, and still it's going to be changing. I have very good speakers with me, but prior to that, let me introduce my co-panelists on the dais. Along with me, I am Pradeep Sharma. I have Professor P.K. Pandey, Professor Rohit Saxena on the other side, Professor Rashmin Gandhi, and as speaker, we would be having Dr. Jyoti Matalia from Narayan Netralay. Dr. Rohit Saxena again would be speaking. Dr. Kamlesh, myself would be speaking on one topic. We have Dr. Mahesh from Arvind. Dr. Kumudini Sharma, please come over in the front row. Whenever Dr. Mahesh comes, please come on the first row. So we'll start with no further digression. And the first topic is, what are the recent paradigm shift in management of amblyopia? As you all know, amblyopia is an age-old subject, and there has been a treatment which is much, much ager older. But we have now newer paradigms to revive the interest and treat amblyopia. And we have Professor Rohit Saxena, who is working with us. And now we also have Dr. Sumita Agarkar to tell us about the genetics in next topic. So Dr. Rohit Saxena, over to you.
Thank you very much, sir. And thank you to the organizers to give me an opportunity to come to this first national symposium on strabismus and neuro-ophthalmology. So we'll talk about some changes that are happening in amblyopia, which is for many years fairly stagnant, but now we are having some very new and exciting work that is going on, and we are changing our understanding and intervention opportunities. Of course, the key changes or scientific development happened when the Nobel Prize winning Hubel and Wiesel demonstrated cortical plasticity and the effect of sensory deprivation and ocular dominance columns in the visual cortex, clearly placing amblyopia from the eye or an ophthalmic disorder to a brain disorder, and showed that there are changes in the ocular dominance columns which are supposed to develop normally like this, but with one eye occluded in kittens, there was a complete change, and the ocular dominance columns became responsive only to one eye. So prevention of amblyopia is something very key. In fact, before we talk management, it is key to understand that we should, if possible, prevent it. So the key thing is screening of children at risk. So it is very important that we screen the children who are at risk, particularly those who have some other associated problems. We need to prescribe appropriate refractive correction, strengthen our school screening program, and if possible, start a pre-screening program. Try and see if our infants can be first screened by non-ophthalmologists, and high-risk children can be screened by ophthalmologists, and then treat the underlying disorder, if any, that can cause amblyopia to occur. So early identification and intervention in the critical group is key to prevent and manage and restore binocularity. The important considerations are age, so the earlier you pick them up, the better it is. Duration of the problem, refractive errors, correct the refractive errors and their type, associated strabismus and other causes like other media opacities, and of course compliance. So these are key considerations which we must when we are managing patients. So what are current treatment guidelines, or what do we look for? So one, we need to remove the amblyopiogenic factor. So as discussed, anything that is responsible should be removed. You need to give them appropriate optical correction, which means that age-appropriate cycloplegic correction should be given, and particularly if there is a strabismus or an esotropia associated, you need to remove the factors that can cause an esotropia and a subsequent amblyopia. Of course, occlusion for more than a century is the sheet anchor treatment for amblyopia, and it is important that we continue to recognize its place in our treatment. However, there are options which we are going on with: penalization, a discussion on active vision therapy, and pharmacotherapy. So optical correction, as I said, age-appropriate cycloplegic refraction and prescription of glasses is key. And pedigs have also shown that some amount of amblyopia can easily get corrected just by refractive correction alone. And if you are looking at ametropic amblyopia, which is due to an uncorrected refractive error in both the eyes, the only treatment required is an appropriate correction of glasses. This is the national expert-based consensus statement regarding prescription of glasses for the prevention and management of amblyopia. These were guidelines that have been circulated. In fact, if any of you is interested, you can collect your copy from the CIPLA stall right now, and we hope that they'll be distributed to all AIOS members subsequently. And these are the levels which we feel are ideal or should be prescribed so that we can prevent amblyopia. These are a little different from the AAO guidelines, which was put up, which has been recommended by the AAO, our PAS committee, but we felt we have adjusted them a little to tune to our conditions we feel that are important. So occlusion therapy was the gold standard, gives preferential chance of development to the amblyopic eye, and you have the option of full-time occlusion, which sometimes can be difficult for children, especially older children, and part-time occlusion. So there have been the PEDIC studies which have said that six hours in severe amblyopia and up to 2 hours only in moderate amblyopia may provide significant visual improvement. We follow a very standard, very simple to remember kind of back of the envelope system, that if you're giving full-time occlusion, you give 1:1 for a one-year-old, and as the age grows, it becomes 6:1 for the entire week for 6 years and above. So this is when you're prescribing full-time occlusion, but for part-time occlusion, you need not shift it to the amblyopic eye, because in the other times, the better eye is anyway being stimulated. So you can just give a particular number of hours of occlusion of the better eye. You need to remember that you can never stop suddenly. You should not stop, because the recurrence of amblyopia has been reported to up to 50%, and in our study we had found it to be at least 13%. So it's very important that you maintain even after the vision is equalized and gradually taper. There are of course these PEDIC glasses or amblyopist glasses which kind of work like occlusion, but they are smarter and definitely more expensive, so the patient parents feel that yes, they are actually doing something for their child rather than just the 5 rupee patch, which they may feel is really not doing anything. So they of course work on the same principle. They intermittently occlude the dominant eye and stimulate the non-dominant eye to perform the routine functions. There is pharmacological therapies that have been tried, levodopa and citicoline. Citicoline now is available oral. So of course studies are underway, but at present the consensus is that levodopa and along with carbidopa does not significantly in the long term have a major impact on outcomes compared to occlusion alone. So unless you have a person who is resistant, who is a failed occlusion, you may think that occlusion maybe still continues to be the first line therapy. You of course have a lot of other drugs that are now being under experimentation, but till the time we get actual evidence of impact, they're still very far from being standard of care. Active vision therapy is now a concept that we are discussing. Instead of just allowing the child to patch and just waste his time doing nothing and may even be dozing off in the middle, the aim is that whatever number of hours you're giving the patch to, the amblyopic eye should be actively and actually stimulated. So they are allowed to do as much tab, games, TV, whatever they like, so that whatever duration the amblyopic eye is seeing, it is constantly being stimulated with high activity, including improving hand-eye coordination in the form of playing video games. There are other therapies like behavioral treatment methods like perceptual learning, dichoptic training, and virtual reality, which can be augmented. So perceptual learning acts by a concept that practice makes us perfect. So certain tasks which are strongly stimulative of the visual pathway are repeatedly administered, which may include Gabor patch detection, contrast detection, or even just vernier acuity detection. So these are ways in which you're stimulating and you expect that the visual pathway as a whole improves. However, the downside is that we generally have till now found improvement only in the tasks that are practiced, and it is not globally active for stimulating the visual system. And actually they are currently still in the lab setting and have not been replicated at home. You can augment that with high frequency transcranial random noise stimulation, which actually acts by increasing the background in electrical activity of the brain, and you expect that the visual pathway that is being strongly stimulated may actually be may get better. This has been tried to be augmented pharmacologically. However, again, as of now, there are no clear evidence that it is acting greatly. So the other thing now is dichoptic training, that two eyes are better than one. You present an independent stimulus to both the eyes. However, you reduce the quality of the image by changing the contrast in the dominant eye so that the amblyopic eye is the one which is the stimulus coming from the amblyopic eye is equally strong. And you promote binocular development of the vision. And the aim is that because the visual system is a binocular system, you expect to improve visual acuity and improve the binocular system without actually compromising on the better eye vision like occlusion therapy does. So it promotes the simultaneous use of both the eyes and helps us. So these are the kind of games. One eye sees this, the other eye sees this, and this is the binocular. So one eye has a dulled image, or the dominant eye has a dulled image, so that equal stimulation occurs. This has been in the form of games, and you can do by the Red-Green Dissociation, the online games that are available, and a fairly good improvement has been seen. We've also completed a study where we found some good results. The downside was the games are at present, the free to download games are not so interesting, so children do tend to lose interest much earlier. And now, of course, we have another Digger game, and hopefully more games will evolve as this way of treating amblyopia gains confidence. So it's also now moved to the VR goggles, so children may find it very interesting to play very active action-oriented games while they are being treated for their amblyopia. Just last, I'll talk to you about the fMRI. That is something that we are looking at constantly, and it is something that is teaching us how the brain is acting. So it just uses the oxygenation of the blood to tell us the activity of the brain. And we had done a study in strabismic amblyops, and we found that there is a generalized reduction in bilateral visual cortex when viewing with the amblyopic eye, and it tends to recover with time, and the enhancement of cortical activity occurs as the amblyopic eye recovers from occlusion. And we hope that over time we are able to predict children who are going to benefit from amblyopia therapy. We had done a study on the diffusion tensor imaging, where we track out the visual pathway or any nerve, the movement of the nerve by tracking. So this is the last slide.
Okay.
By looking at the water track pathways, and although this technology is still developing, we hope that it will be able to help us to prognosticate how we can treat and how children respond. So this hopefully is the future of amblyopia diagnostics. To summarize, it is important to give refractive correction, treat the children, follow them up, and make sure that they do not develop recurrences. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rohit. I think the paradigm shift, as you are noticing, is there. Much more interesting is going to happen with the technology coming to our rescue and with the newer brains coming in. We have now the next topic, which is again going to be a changing paradigm. Dr. Jyoti Matalia from Narayan Netralaya, Bangalore, is going to tell us how are we managing the nystagmus in today's times and what's new that is going to happen. Please preserve your questions. We'll have it at the end. You can send them questions in writing here, or maybe till the last. Dr. Jyoti.
Yeah. You can start. Yeah. Right. Thank you, Dr. Sharma, for allowing me to be a part of this national symposium. What I am going to be talking about is management of nystagmus today. Now, what is the objective in treating nystagmus? One, improve visual acuity by stabilizing the eyes, diminishing the amplitude and frequency of nystagmus movement to shift the null zone, to correct strabismus when present, and to decrease any oscillopsia. So I decided to summarize this into older and newer. And in older, I said, let's look at each of them as less used and regularly used. So let's look at each of this category, and at the end, I will give you what is primarily to be done now. So the less used are the prisms, chemo denervation, artificial diversion surgeries. So what is prism? These are used to correct the head posture, and we put them by keeping the apex pointing to the null point. So like, for example, this is how the glasses are. If you see the face turn to the left, it's corrected with the base-in prism in the right eye and a base-out prism in the left eye. Similarly, for those which have a convergence null, you can use bilateral base-out prisms with minus one diopter for allowing accommodation and stimulating conversions. And with this, you can correct for the dampening of effect. So this is how it's seen when you use the red without prisms and green with prisms, but need to understand that these are high-powered prisms. If you use them for longer time, you can cause optically disadvantages. Now, chemo denervation, it is used to reduce the amplitude of nystagmus, has been shown to improve foveation time and therefore improve visual acuity in oscillopsia, better for neurological acquired nystagmus, but wears off if you're giving intra in the muscle. The retrobulbar injection lasts longer. This is how you can give it, but it has its complications. Third is artificial diversion surgery, which is used in congenital nystagmus to induce extra conversions innervation by weakening the medial recti to dampen nystagmus, either bimedial recession to induce some amount of exophoria or unilateral recess resect to be done. The idea is to improve vision. So let's come back to the next part, older but regularly used. One is glasses, contact lens, and the other one is surgery. Very, very important. You have to correct the refractive error. And for that, you need to know your refraction very well. First, do binocular vision assessment in the preferred head posture. Then you can use the forced primary position and see. When you're actually checking uniocular vision, remember, do not occlude because you can induce a latent nystagmus. You should use fogging lenses. And then you can use glasses with tints, which can help especially in case of those with sensory causes, with albinism, etc. You can maybe introduce some small prisms as well. Contact lens, better useful because visual axis coincides with the optical axis and tactile feedback from contact lens decreases with nystagmus. However, this was the old concept where the glasses and high plus glasses with high minus contact lens were used, but now it is not much used at all. Then coming to the surgical treatment, basically you need to have certain surgical principles when you're treating nystagmus. One is to decrease the amplitude of nystagmus by maximal recession of horizontal muscles as mentioned here. That improves vision. You could also do tenotomy. Tenotomy also increases foveation time. As it has been shown by Deloso and Hertel, that it's on the principles of proprioceptive input to the nystagmus. They say tenotomy and re-suturing back can improve foveation on the EMR in nearly all the congenital nystagmus in up to 50%. What they have seen, this is how you can see, what exactly improves is what they call the NAFX, which is the expanded nystagmus acuity function, an indicator of the target foveation, which fastens the target acquisition time and therefore reduces oscillopsia. You can see that before tenotomy and after tenotomy, there's definitely an improvement, which is noted. The other aspects of doing surgery is rotating the null point. One is Anderson, where you do basically bilateral recessions. Kestenbaum, which is resect. And this is one of the modifications of Kestenbaum Parks, where you use 13 millimeters on either sides, but does not correct more than 15 degree of the face turn. Then you have the augmented Kestenbaum. For more degree of face turn, you can go into an augmented by 40 and 60% respectively. This is a child with strabismus. What do you do when you have it? Like this is a patient with left face turn and left ET. So what we did surgery in the right eye because that's a fixing eye. We did nystagmus surgery. So two, the nystagmus surgery in the eye that is fixing and followed by squint in the other. And I prefer to do modified Anderson and this is what we've done. You see the face turn has improved. There are other problems, however, you should understand when you do these surgeries. One, acquiring a new head posture. And that happens if it's a periodic alternating nystagmus. So very, very important when you decide to operate for a face turn, assess the face turn properly, have at least two visits, and give 3 minutes of assessment in your clinic to see if it changes. And just in case you've operated and now the new face turn has come, then you need to operate on the other muscles which are not untouched if you've done a modified Anderson. And secondly, creating a new strabismus. Now, verticals are the same aspect, same principle. What you need to understand is turn the eyes in the direction of the face turn. That is primarily important. Now, coming to the newer aspects which we have, one which are regularly used, these are the drugs that we use in acquired nystagmus. This is a review which gives us all the details. And as you can see, in acquired pendular nystagmus, you can use gabapentin and baclofen. In congenital idiopathic nystagmus, memantine, which is the newer thing which is common. Then 4-aminopyridine, which is for vertical upbeat and downbeat nystagmus. Carbamazepine is for superior oblique myokemia. Propranolol for opsoclonus. Acetazolamide and brinzolamide for infantile nystagmus. And on brinzolamide, topical brinzolamide was introduced by Deloso, which is published in Journal of Neuroaffairs in 2011, stating that if you give this for 3 times a day, there is some amount of improvement noted in the foveation time. However, he asked to do a randomized study, which was then followed and been done by Hertel, and that was published in BJO in 2015. But he used only 5 cases. They received basically Azopt, followed by a washout period, and then Azopt or placebo. But they did mention that there is an improvement, but he expects to have more cases to be enrolled to decide whether it really works. Now, coming to the other aspect, the still experimental and partly being used. One is the surgery, which I'll talk about, and some newer aspects. Now, basically, another aspect of surgery came the augmented tendon suture, which is gotten by Deloso, where you use an augmented tenotomy followed by reattachment or just augmented tendon suture without tenotomy. What they said is there's basically an aspect of mechanical also as an alternative approach, and by using this augmented suture, that may help and reduce the proprioceptive impulses, which was the same theory that they had thought of initially. So this is what they actually did. The first one is the tenotomy, where you disinsert and then you reinsert. Second is you use these augmented tendon sutures, which are the crossed sword sutures, two of them, but you do not attach them to the globe, it's just put into the muscle. Similarly, you can split the tendon and use this, and they say this eventually may help. And then finally, a distal tendon tenotomy. Others we look at is basically acupuncture, a study which has come in 2017, which was done in congenital and acquired nystagmus, but obviously very few cases. They wanted to see the short-term effect of visual function, and they saw about 6 patients, and they felt that there was, where they use a needle acupuncture, and felt that there was some scope, and then we should be studying it further. So it's still experimental. And finally, magnetic oculomotor processes for acquired nystagmus. What they basically felt that physical dampening of the oscillation can be used as an alternative. They have used a 2-part titanium encased earth magnet, which they implanted in the area, and they found that in only a single case report, that can actually be done. So this has been published in ophthalmology. So more studies need to be known to know if physically holding it can really make a difference. Then there's a concept of gene analysis and counseling. Basically, if there's a sensory cause and we're looking at LCA or RP, we need to rule out an RP65 gene. Or if it's a congenital idiopathic, there is a FRMD7 gene which has come in. So obviously, it doesn't mean that there is, but by history examination, if you're able to find out the sensory cause, you evaluate for the same, or FRMD for the congenital idiopathic, and then it leaves for some scope of research in future. Hence, to summarize, if we are looking at the total for today, we are looking at these as a basic treatment, what we can do. So to say that evaluation of nystagmus is multidisciplinary, it is possible to improve the quality of life with drugs, optical devices, and surgical procedures. No single procedure has been shown to consistently predict the success, but it does not mean we cannot try. We should keep on trying. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jyoti, for very nicely bringing out the newer things that are going to happen in the field of nystagmus. There is a lot of hope for all of us and for the children who are having nystagmus. With surgery, we are changing the eccentric point only, but with the medical treatment and the enhanced Hertel-Deloso procedures, there will be something new. We will now request another new thing which is going to happen, that is genetics, how it can help us in the field of strabismus and neuro-ophthalmology. And we have Dr. Sumita Agarkar from Shankar Netralaya to tell us about that. Please keep your questions and you can send them here so that we can have it at the end.
I'm standing in for Dr. Meenakshi Swaminathan, who was originally supposed to give this talk. Those who have heard her know that I am a poor replacement, but I will do my
No,
best.
That's just a disclaimer.
So, we are going to talk on genetics and neuro-ophthalmology here, but probably what I am going to say applies to a lot of, in terms of ophthalmology itself. Since several years, genetic diseases and different formations of genetic diseases have invoked curiosity, revulsion, sometimes had a, and we had freak shows in six, where people with genetic diseases were put on display. I think we have come a long way from them, from being just curious, and knowledge of genetics is essential, not only for diagnosis and prognosis, but also to offer our patients emerging treatments. So application of genetics in clinical practice can be prenatal detection, like it is now available for retinoblastoma, and especially the familial forms of retinoblastoma. It helps you in early diagnosis in preclinical stage and sometimes change the course of the disease. And treatment, in terms of treatment for targeted gene therapies, which are available, and also for the prognosis and counseling. So basically, if you have to summarize, you use genetics for diagnosis, for therapeutics, and for counseling. So when you come, we all have patients seen like this, where both parents or children with genetic diseases are very often a part of your everyday OPD. So from the diagnostic point of view, several multisystem disorders have genetic background. It is important to recognize and do appropriate genetic testing to confirm the diagnosis. Cranial disinnervation syndromes like Duane syndrome and Mobius, which were thought to be only localized misinnervation, have now proved to have genetic mutations which are responsible, not probably in every patient, but several of them. So unless we don't test and we don't know this, we may not be able to tell when the parents ask why my child has this. Similarly, something like a horizontal gaze palsy with a progressive scoliosis is a very rare autosomal recessive disorder and characterized by eye movement abnormalities which appear right at birth and tends to associated with progressive scoliosis. This association between these two things which are disparate could not have been possible without a knowledge of genetics here. So it basically leads due to the presence of an abnormal decussation which leads to miswiring of the neural pathways and abnormal eye movements, and cognitive functions in these children is usually normal. We still don't know how the scoliosis happens because of this, but gene which has been identified, the mutation is RoBO3 gene on chromosome 11, and there have been several mutations which have been described with similar phenotype here. And actually there is a study where they are actually recruiting subjects for this because it's so rare. And so this kind of multi-system disorders, we need the knowledge of genetics to diagnose or to connect two different things in eye and neuro-ophthalmology and strabismus with something else in the body. CPO is also again example of something like this. Multi-system involvement, acquired strabismus with limited motility, can have systemic anomalies like cardiomyopathy and hypogonadism. A variation of this can be also Kearns-Sayre syndrome, which also has heart block. But in terms of CPO, there is presence of ragged red fibers in ocular movements, which lead to this kind of ocular muscles, which lead to this kind of motility issues. But now it is with the newer knowledge, we know it is the maternal DNA, which mitochondrial DNA, which is deletions and mutations, which are responsible for this disease. And at least three genes are known, which can be tested. Now coming to the role of genetics in therapeutics, it is a rapidly evolving field. And actually last year, which has caused a lot of presence of a first FDA approved gene therapy for hereditary retinal disorder like LCA is now available, and many others are in the pipeline which are targeted therapies. So let's talk about, since this is neuro-ophthalmology, let's talk about LHON. It is leads to bilateral sequential visual loss. It is a disease which affects young males, and degeneration of the retinal ganglion cells are responsible for this. And again, we know mutations are mitochondrial DNA which lead to this, with several different phenotypes. Now this particular problem is very, very uniquely placed. It's like a laboratory to test for gene therapy because it is a single gene disorder, and at least three mutations have been described with their various frequencies. The top one, 11778 mutation, is most common and probably most vision threatening and affects. Why we need to learn about this? Because of the sequential nature of the disease, it allows you to have some kind of time frame to alter the thing. So here, patients, clinical trials have used intravitreal injections of recombinant AAV or a virus vector carrying ND4 genes that, in the hopes that normal gene expression within the retinal ganglion cells will restore and review functions. So in a study by Van et al., people with worse visual acuities were injected with a single dose of this viral recombinant gene, and at 9 months post-injection, 7 of the 9 patients improved to best corrected visual acuity of at least 0.3 logMAR. So there is a chance that these young males, affected patients, can be helped by this. Improvement was not only noted in the eye which was injected, but also in uninjected eyes. There were no adverse event or drop in the visual acuity from baseline in this trial. There are several other trials which are under review for LHON, and we probably where there is vectors which are virus vectors as well as non-virus vectors as well as neuroprotection, all is being tried in these patients. Now third role of genetics is counseling. The aim of genetic counseling is to inform the patients that their families about how this condition affects them now and in the future, and also to explain its reproductive implications. it is not simply a question of defining risks and improving or explaining how it has inherited. When you see a child like this in your OPD with a blepharophimosis syndrome, you need to know that whether she has a type 1 blepharophimosis, which has a chance of ovarian failure, primary ovarian failure and infertility, or a type 1 which does not have ovarian failure, or a type 2 which is linked to ovarian failure. Your parents of this child who comes to the OPD needs to know, and for that you need to have genetic analysis. Although FOXL2 gene can produce both type 1 and type 2, but as doctors we should inform the parents not just about 4 or 5 lid surgeries and strabismus surgeries which you are going to do, but also about this. As doctors, your job is not complete unless you talk about this. So distinction between type 1 and type 2 is important, especially if those who have de novo mutations and no family history of blepharophimosis. Just to sound a word of caution, genetic testing is now available widely, but it needs careful interpretation and skill to be useful as a diagnostic and prognostic tool. Similarly, counseling can be complex and comes with a set of ethical and social challenges which need to be understood, and ethical questions are not yet fully answered on what to tell and how much to tell to the parents. What we still don't know, or where the research, since this is strabismus, we still don't know the molecular basis of concomitant strabismus. Twin studies, family studies have indicated genetic influence. 30% of children with strabismus do have a family member, but we know there are significant environmental factors which play a role, like myopia. So these are the areas where there is need for more research and more knowledge. I would like to invite you to these two conferences, which are, one is, since this is neuroophthal also, please, this is my personal invitation to come for a Synapse, which is 28th and 29th September, and those who do retina, there is a pediatric retina conference in Shankarnethralaya. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Sunita. In fact, genetics is changing very rapidly, and I think we'll understand things much better. Only thing is that between the genotype and phenotype, there's not always a direct relationship, so that probably with time we'll have more better clarification. Like CFM cases, you find
counseling is a little bit still complex, needs a very, very careful and skilled interpretation
and
genetic testing.
And surveillance also, I mean, how they behave later. So all those areas are very interesting and challenging.
Yes.
And I think a lot of work is being done on that. Thank you so much. And our next speaker is Professor Pradeep Sharma. He'll be talking about neurosurgical techniques for paralytic strabismus. Paralytic strabismus, as you know, is very complicated and challenging at times. And we will find no better speaker than Professor Pradeep Sharma. He has very extensive experience in these conditions, and he'll be telling us in a very comprehensive way. Professor Pradeep.
Thank you, Professor Pandey. I think now we have had the newer things which have happened in genetics to help us. But as surgeons, I think we are most comfortable with the surgical techniques, and I'm going to talk about the newer surgical techniques. Whenever there is a case of third nerve palsy in which the eye can go past the midline, we are very happy, because a maximal recession and a resection can help, and the eyes are straight, even though the adduction may not be to the best possible thing. But the problem can sometimes be more complex, and whenever the problem is complex, we have to have a different approach, like these large angle deviations. Dr. Rosenbaum's book has the algorithm for transposition. If the eye is not passing the midline, you can look for the AFGT, the active force generation test, or you can look for the saccadic velocities clinically, or even measure it. And if you find there is some force, probably you can still do a resection of the weak muscle. But otherwise, we have to do transposition. And in the books, you see several types of transposition procedures. Some have good effects, some have not. Now, this is a girl who comes with a left lateral rectus palsy with the face turned to the left. The eye does not cross the midline. There is an esotropia of about 55-60 prisms. So what do we do? In such a case, a resection will not be of much help of the lateral rectus. The medial rectus recession can be done. So what we do in addition is a vertical rectus transposition using the superior and the inferior rectus, transpose it. But to save the vascular supply, we may use partial width of the superior and the inferior rectus, and we are vectorizing the force toward the missing muscle, that is the lateral rectus. So this is the Foster's suture, which are applied 8 millimeters behind to enhance the effect of the vertical recti. So this is left sixth nerve palsy pre-op, and post-op she has a straight head and some improved abduction. But we find sometimes that there is an overcorrection, and at times there is an undercorrection. And these are all children or adults who have diplopia, so they are not going to be happy unless we can make it an adjustable procedure. But the problem is that when you put Foster's sutures, you cannot adjust. So you need to have an adjustable partial VRT, and that is what we did with this procedure, that we are going to have a vertical rectus split, brought it to the lateral rectus, but then make it a cross action so that we can put the superior rectus half towards the inferior pole of the lateral rectus and the inferior rectus half towards the superior pole. And this is what schematically you will see in this diagram. Can you see here? So this is where we are bringing the sutures, and this inferior half is going here. This is how the schematic diagram shows you. And this is 1.5 knot. So at the time of intraoperatively, you can first ensure that there is no vertical disability that you have created. And after 5 hours, you can adjust it to your maximum ability that we can give a diplopia-free position and give the best possible that is there. Sometimes we find that after the lateral rectus recession, and we find that the muscle is not having enough force, what can we do? We can use a modified Nishida's procedure. This is another new procedure which has come, and I find it useful whenever we have to use the vertical recti without disinserting, without splitting. This is basically putting the sutures like a Foster's suture, but here the difference is we have not disinserted the muscles, and it gives us a vector force which is quite good. And you can see on a side view, what you'll see is the superior rectus and the inferior rectus. We have stitched it closer to the absent force medial rectus, and see the girl who had a 90 prisms of exo, almost adduction being nil, then after the surgery the adduction has improved in both the eyes. So a bilateral Nishida's procedure along with the lateral rectus maximal recession gives us a straight ahead gaze, binocular vision restored. Sometimes when we want to adjust, I combine a Nishida's procedure along with the opposite antagonist muscle on an adjustable. Now this was a sixth nerve palsy in which the Nishida's procedure has been used on the lateral rectus side, and we have done the medial rectus which is adjustable, and again we can guarantee a diplopia free gaze. Third nerve palsies are a little more difficult to handle because the vertical recti are also paralyzed. So we can use the vertical rectus transposition. Superior oblique has been used age old, but it creates problems. We have seen, so we have left it 20 years back, that there can be very odd abnormal vertical movements. So I would not recommend superior oblique transposition in today's age. Periosteal flaps, I saw Dr. Rosenbaum doing in 2001 when I was doing fellowship, but I found it required Dr. Goldberg, who was an oculoplasty's help. So I changed this to a medial periosteal anchoring using non-absorbable sutures and fixing it to the medial periosteal globe. And this we had published in JPOS some time back, and it's a good procedure to hold the eye in the primary position. The lateral rectus, by the way, has to be recessed supramaximally. So we can also do a periosteal fixing of the lateral rectus itself to take it out of the compartment altogether. And then that can also be giving very straight eyes. In addition to that, medial rectus, we can inject bupivacaine injection. So bupivacaine is a drug which causes toxicity to the muscle and causes the scarring and enhances the effect. But some cases have much more complex problems, like synergistic divergence of this child, in which when she looks to the right side, the movement is less, but when she looks to the left side, the abduction is better in the opposite direction. This is synergistic divergence. So if you see this picture, this child is having, when he looks this side, then the movements are, these are simultaneous abductions occurring on levo gaze. What do we do in such cases? We will shift the lateral rectus in the right eye to the medial rectus position. And this is a short video of that procedure in which we have split the lateral rectus, brought it underneath the superior and the inferior rectus after doing a, see that lateral rectus being hooked, and then this is being separated just like we do for DRS splitting by splitting, but here it's much deeper, about 15 to 20 mm of split. These are 6-0 vicryl sutures being passed at the two ends, and then they are disinserted. This procedure has inadvertently bleeding, but we need to use adrenaline-soaked swab sticks and then bring it underneath the superior rectus. The reverse needles are being passed under the inferior and the superior rectus and brought to the other side. And now we have shifted our position to the opposite side. The medial rectus is being exposed. And you bring it, to have more effect, I have brought the superior to the inferior side and the inferior to the superior side, even crossed action effect to enhance the effect, and then stitched it at the medial rectus insertion side. So this gives us very good correction. And not only that, now the lateral rectus innervation, which was coming in the wrong direction, comes to the right, and so it becomes adduction also, adduction during adduction. This is another situation in which sometimes we find the inferior rectus fires during adduction. This we have described as synergistic innervational downshoot, the SID syndrome, SID, and we published in Canadian Journal. Now this is a video of that child. When he looks to the left side, the right eye dips down. It's like looking towards Tokyo, the other eye looks towards Sydney. And in these cases, what we identify the inferior rectus at the timing is wrong. So what we shift the inferior rectus to the MR position, and you'll find that the video post-op shows you that the adduction has improved and the downshoot has got corrected. So this is schematically bringing this inferior rectus towards the medial rectus. What we say is that this is the targeted strabismus surgery. In today's age, what we would say is even strabismus can be modified as per the requirement. And we have dynamic MRIs which can document. Now this is simultaneous abduction. The lateral rectus is firing in both the directions. In dextro gaze, normally lateral rectus is supposed to fire, but even the lateral rectus of the left eye is firing. And here the synergistic innervational downshoot, when you have the levo gaze, LR of the left eye, and the inferior rectus of the right eye is firing, so bring the IR to the MR. This is what we have done. So what I would like you to leave with a message today of the modern strabismus surgery, it's a targeted strabismus surgery. So then we can guarantee what we want. I would like to thank you all for this patient listening. And before I end my talk, I would like to give you a save the date. What Dr. Sumita Agarkar was mentioning of the another SPOSI annual meeting which we are having on 7th and 8th December 2019 at the prestigious Shankar Netralay. So we have to move south. And we want you all. There are very interesting things. There is one special SPOSI International Hero Award starting this year. There is another interesting thing for the young people, Saab CD or strabismus, in which we'll have beautiful case presentations which will be there. Video assisted strabismus teaching, cases, debates and controversies. Lots of new things. So please come and save your dates on 7th and 8th December on Shankar Netralay. Thank you all.
Thank you, Professor Pradeep, for a very interesting talk. I'm sure there will be many questions, but we'll take them at the end of the session. Our next speaker is Professor Kamlesh. He'll be talking about obliques and how to abnormally acting obliques and how to manage them. Professor Kamlesh.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pandey. I think now after all the horizontal muscles and the gene therapy and etc., now I'm coming to the oblique muscles only. Now I'm going to talk about the very simple and surgical modalities for the abnormally acting supraoblique muscles. As you know, that can be either it underacting or the overacting, or maybe no action, maybe because of the muscle palsy. So the management depends upon entirely on the basis of the etiology, as well as the surgical and the type of the abnormalities which they have. For the strong superior oblique overacting muscles, we have the weakening procedure in the form of tenectomy and the tenectomy, that is the complete one, or the posterior tenectomy, maybe the superior expander, and the stretching procedure in the form of superior oblique tuck at the Harada ATO procedure with the Phelps modifications. Now, the superior oblique tenectomy and the tenectomy is only done in the cases when you see the A pattern of more than 40 prism diopter, means excessive superior oblique overacting, the Brown syndrome of the esomyocemia. But this has the caution must be remembered for everybody that torsional diplopia can occur if there is a presence of binocular foveal fixation. And it should not be done for the expectant, and it can also cause the iatrogenic superior oblique palsy. Now the posterior tenectomy is a relatively new surgery which should be done, which has to be done a pattern up to the 20 prism diopter and with or without DVD. Risk is very minimal. This is the case where you can see there is a exotropia with the superior oblique overactions and which has been well treated by the posterior tenectomy. This is the procedure I am going to show. I'm sorry for the trouble. So this is the surgery where you can have this is the posterior tenectomy. This FDT must be done in each every case before you attempt the start doing the surgery. This is the incision, subconjunctival incision, and after that you have to get the incision into the tenon capsules and then recognition of the superior rectus muscle, hooking it, and after that on the middle side you just recognize the superior oblique tendon by its glistening look. With the gentle hook, we can have exposed this muscle. Like this. And then finally, you have to expose its complete fan separate insertion. Now this way, there's a complete exposure of the muscles. Then bearing the anterior 2 millimeter of its anterior fibers portions, 2 millimeter anterior fiber, anterior portions, rest of the muscles has to be, tenectomy has to be done with a 2-3 millimeter of its tenectomy. Like this. So that's all about the surgery. And that corrects about the 20 prism diopter of the ectopia. Now, the another surgical procedure is the SO expander. This is a very good procedure which lengthens the tendon without altering the muscle's mechanisms at its insertion. And indicated in the A pattern up to the 20 to 25 prism diopter with and without skew deviations. This is the case in the X pattern where this has been tried and well treated along with the inferior oblique recession. Isme video nahi aa raha yaar, kya baat hai? Isliye
finish your talk and show the video.
Nahi main to maine acha laga tha kya hai. तुमने क्या कहा यार? नो नो, आई डोंट नो व्हाट ही हैज डन. इट वाज गोइंग वेल व्हेन आई प्रैक्टिस इट. दैट्स व्हाई आई यूटिलाइज माय ओन लैपटॉप. ये है यार, ये है. इनेबल करो, पहले इनेबल करो, इनेबल करो. हाँ, छोड़ो, हटाओ.
जस्ट
What happens?
Carry on with this, Dr. Kamlesh. You have 2 minutes.
No, it can't be 2 minutes. Huh? This is the fault of.
Just 1 minute now.
You can have finished it, I don't know.
No. Just carry on with the PPT, I'm saying. Videos we can have later on.
Now it's coming, I'm sorry, the time should be remodified. So this is the superior oblique tendon. This seat has been used as like the retinal surgeon. Six to seven millimeters you can do, and you have to put it in between the two portions of the tendon, in between the tendons, just the naturally enlarging the muscles, and fixated by the non-absorbable sutures, and that's all. And the procedure is SO tucking, which is indicated for the profound superior oblique under actions without inferior oblique overactions. Remember, and that correct around 15 to 20% after the esotropia in the down gauge positions. This is the right superior oblique palsy where superior oblique tendon has been done. Tucking has been done. It's on by my own way. Now, here as like exposing the muscles, superior oblique muscles, there's a 7 millimeter tucking. At the 7 millimeter distance, we have to pass the sutures and then again revert it back towards the insertion site. And here is the anchoring of the sclera. This is very easy procedure. This is just modified it so that it can be easier for the everybody to do it, even for the poor graduates. And again, from the same place, and simply what we have to do, just you have to pull this suture, tie it, and then cut it. And that's all. This is the tucking. The one video is left, and I will show it. The Harada IT procedure, I'm leaving it. Now the inferior oblique weakening procedures are 2 minutes only because of the disturbance. This is the decrease the absolute in adducted positions, and or maybe the permanently avalis, or the at least decrease the V pattern as and when associated. These are the indications for the inferior oblique weakening. There are a lot of procedures which has been practiced, but the most probably conventional decision has been practiced by most of the people. But there are variable results, and the surgical landmark has to be remembered in these cases. And there is no golden standard for this. And it can also further cause the inadvertent low perforation, snaring of the tenon capsules, as well there is no provision of customizations. So we have thought of doing the hangbag muscle resection technique, which has not been done prior because of the flexor muscle, less tenderness, and do not retract like the recti. We believe that the inferior oblique muscle will retract into its sheath and shall stay recessed according to the amount of the resection done. This is the procedure which I want to show it. The exposure of the inferior oblique muscles like in the normal way. I just want to how to pass the suture. The 6 row vital sutures has been passed from the distance of 4 millimeter from the insertion site, and making a loop from the 1 millimeter from the insertion site. Now see, this is the loop, and what you have to do simply that you have to cut the muscle across and pull the sutures and measure according to the, your need, depending upon the over function of the inferior oblique muscles, and that's all. So
thank you, Professor Kamlesh, for very nicely covering the oblique muscles, which are little less handled by most people. And we would have the questions later on if there are any. We will now move on to the next talk, Dr. Mahesh from Arvind, and he is going to tell us about the changes or newer things which are happening in imaging in the field of strabismus and neuro-ophthalmology. Dr. Mahesh.
Just 8 minutes. 8 minutes. So this has been well published in the JAPAS and all that with the 93.3% results, the excellent results. So finally, what I want to say that this is a landmark free surgery with the minimal manipulations, easily gradable from 6 mm to 12 mm, with the no advanced perforation and the less chances of snaring up the T9 capsules, as well as you have the provision of intraoperative and the postoperative customizations. Thank you very much.
Thank you once again, Professor Kamlesh. So now we have Dr. Mahesh. And again, as you know, imaging till now we were doing only neuro-ophthalmology for ruling out intracranial space occupying lesions or papilledema. But we can use neuroimaging for much more things, and even for strabismus. By the way, you must have known Deemer's work on the pulleys has come from imaging. So the high definition MRIs are coming in a big way. fMRIs, as Dr. Rohit had also mentioned, for amblyopia conditions, which are otherwise, so imaging is going to be a great help in the future. So I think look forward to it. And Dr. Mahesh is very well trained for this talk particularly. We requested him to take this.
Good morning, one and all. First of all, I'd like to thank Professor Sharma for having invited me here. So I'll be talking on newer imaging techniques, specifically neuro-ophthalmology. So briefly on the indications of neuroimaging, visual acuity or field loss, motility disorders, pupillary abnormalities, pain syndromes, papilledema, or any new onset of recent onset of headache. So a brief backup of the information. CT using ionizing radiation like X-rays are good for bony structures and blood in situations like trauma, calcified lesions like tumors, optic disc drusen, or an acute subarachnoid hemorrhage. MRI is good for soft tissue lesions, especially in neuro-ophthalmology in optic neuritis to rule out multiple sclerosis, and as well as evaluation of papilledema, including MR venogram, as well as detecting other optic nerve soft tissue injury and muscle entrapment in injury. Other indications are listed here. So basics about T1 and T2. In T1, every fluid is dark. You can see the vitreous as well as the CSF being dark here. And then orbital fat is bright though, which is going to impede our findings, which we'll see shortly. T2 is all the fluid is bright. CSF and vitreous is white or hyper intense. And orbital fat also is bright here. Again, we'll see why, how it can be suppressed. So pathology, what is black and white on T1 and T2? Black on both T1 and T2 will be calcium, gas, rapid flowing blood, and cortical blown. Calcium lacking significant water, has less amount of hydrogen atoms, so it appears black, and similarly cortical bone. Rapidly flowing blood, there is no enough time for the protons to give back the signals, and it rapidly flows away, so the MRI cannot pick up the signals. So a rapidly flowing blood will show black on T1 and T2. And what is white on T1 and T2? Subacute hematomas, stationary or slow moving blood like a thrombosis. It will show up as bright signals in MRI. Similarly, fat, lipoma, melanin, and gadolinium are bright in T1 and T2. Gado shortens relaxation time and leads to breakdown of the blood. It concentrates on situations where there is breakdown of blood-brain barrier like neoplasm, infection, or inflammation. Though normal enhancement can be seen in the nasal mucosa being a very vascular structure, as well as the extraocular muscles, and also the pituitary gland, the posterior part of the pituitary gland is fat-laden, and so it appears bright in normally even without contrast. So discussing about some of the newer strategies for neuroimaging, we have the short T1 inversion recovery sequences, which suppresses the fat. We have fluid attenuated inversion recovery or FLAR images. We'll see where it is indicated, especially in cases of multiple sclerosis. Basically, it suppresses the fluid. We have diffusion weighted images. We are measuring the restriction of diffusion of water to detect the pathology. We have MR spectroscopy or MRS. We have diffusion tensor imaging, which Dr. Rohit was discussing. Of course, we have functional MRI as well as other. We'll see the STIR imaging sequences. So basically, STIR is a short inversion, T1 inversion recovery sequence. So we'll see what it is indicated. This is a normal T2. You can see here, this is a normal T2 sequence, a coronal image, and you can see the nerve in the center and the surrounding fluid, which is bright, which is seen in T2. So this is normal and it is called as a target sign. But what happens if there is a optic neuritis? We see there is a loss of this hypo intensity in the nerve, and we see the whole thing becomes hyper intense. This is called as loss of target sign. Supposing we have the fat which is fully bright here, we will not be able to appreciate this loss of target sign and everything will become bright. We need to pick out the bright optic nerve and we need to suppress the fat surrounding it. And so this is called as a fat suppressed STER image, which is useful for bringing out optic neuritis. So as for the radiologist will give you this image for optic neuritis. So next most important thing is the FLAR images. Fluid attenuated inversion recovery sequence. So what is this fluid attenuation? So discussing about the T1 and T2, T1 is used for normal anatomy and T2 is used for pathology. So good pathology is seen in T2 images. But what happens here, if in T2 the fluid and the CSF is very bright and we want to see as something like a bright plaque in multiple sclerosis in T2. So this is a FLAR image. And supposing this fluid, this CSF was very bright here, we will not be able to appreciate the multiple sclerosis plaques in T2. So we need to suppress the fluid, and that is what this T2 does. Similarly, you can see this these bright hyperintense signals, the plaques, multiple sclerosis plaques, after suppressing the fluid in the ventricles, and that's how the FLAR images helps us to pick out all these multiple sclerosis lesions. So you may ask us, now you have suppressed all the fluid is appearing dark. How do you differentiate a T1 and a T2 in this? So that's a very valid question, because T1 also is fluid is dark, T2 also we have suppressed here, the fluid is dark. How do we know this is T2? So a simple algorithm is white and gray is gray in T1. Gray matter is gray and white matter is white in T1. The reverse is true in T2. So you can see here T2, the gray matter is white and the white matter is gray. And so that's how we roughly identify what is T1 and T2 even in the presence of a FLAR images. So the next most important concept is a diffusion weighted imaging. So this is a very old CT which shows that you can see a hyper dense CT, we use the term density, hyper dense lesion in the posterior cerebral artery territory, leading to a macular sparing homonymous hemianopia. So nowadays we use MRI, and what you see here in this picture is a very old chronic infarct, and CT is very, very bad in picking up very acute infarcts. So what do we do instead? We try to use MRI images. MRI images are also good in picking up acute infarcts, but not the very hyperacute infarcts. So MRI may show positivity or hyperintense lesions in the occipital lobe maybe in the first 8 to 12 hours or even 24 hours. But we have the golden period of 6 hours to thrombolyze the patient to recover the fields. So what we need is a diffusion restricted sequence. So what is the principle of diffusion restriction is, whenever there is an ischemia or the infarct, the cellular diffusion is restricted and there is edematous brain and the fluid accumulates and it appears as bright diffusion weighted images. These are all called diffusion weighted images. How do we identify the diffusion weighted images? You can see the normal MRI sequence, you can see the all the details very clearly, whereas in the diffusion weighted images you are not able to see the other structures of the brain clearly, but what you see only is the bright signals or the hyperintense signals in a hyperacute infarct. So whenever you see a patient with an acute, the patient comes within 2 hours, I cannot see on this side or I cannot see this, and you see a homonymous field defect, rush the patient to do a diffusion weighted imaging and immediately send the patient to the neurologist to thrombolyze, and that is the value of diffusion weighted imaging. So this is another diffusion weighted imaging. You can see all the pixelated brain signals. You don't see the accurate brain details. You see them as pixelated signals, and you can see the, however, you can see the bright hyperintense signals of the infarct. So other not so recent, but which has been relatively used commonly, is the MR venography or the MR venogram to detect venous sinus thrombosis. This is a normal MR venogram. You can see all the sequence, all the superior sagittal sinus and the transverse sinuses. Remember that MR venography is a non-contrast image. You don't need to put a contrast. It's by special sequence and software they do it.
Mahesh, you might have to conclude.
Yeah, I'm wrapping up. So you can see here, in a pathology, there is a thrombosis. You cannot see the signals. MR spectroscopy is one more information which gives biochemical information. When you cannot differentiate, you can see all these biochemical markers, choline, creatinine, NSTL, acetic acid. All these give specific information which the MR, the radiologist use to give the biochemical characteristics. And we also use the 3D reconstruction images to see the vascular structures, and the radiologists are using this. And in case of hemifacial spasm, we use what is called as a MR neurogram to pick out all the finer details of the nerves. So as for the MR neurogram to the radiologist, if you see any hemifacial spasms, and you can see Dr. Rohit has already described that diffusion tensor imaging to pick out the white matter tracks and see if there is any loss of the white matter tracks. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you, Dr. Mahesh. I think it was a stirring talk with your special flair. So I think we really enjoyed it, and there are newer things which are happening for all of us. But there are certain things which are age old, that is optic neuritis, but the management has been changing, and what is the update on it? We have Dr. Kumudni Sharma from Sanjay Gandhi Institute from Lucknow to tell us about that.
Good morning to all, and thanks to Dr. Pradeep for making me a part of this symposium. And my presentation is about the management update in optic neuritis. It's not coming. It was there.
Any questions you can write down and send? So we can have time for it. Kya hua?
Okay, I would be talking about the update in optic neuritis management. It's not moving. Okay. As we all know, the optic neuritis and the inflammatory demyelinating disorder, which could be idiopathic or maybe a part of MS, and it presents clinically as an acute monocular painful visual loss. And optic neuritis can be presenting features of MS in 15-20% cases, and 50% cases of MS we develop optic neuritis in sometime during the course of illness. Now the main focus on the treatment of optic neuritis is improving the vision of the patient and preventing the conversion of this patient to MS. Now about the acute treatment of these cases, the patient who is presenting with acute optic neuritis to us, a short-term management of these cases is steroid. Corticosteroid, mainly as all we know, the intravenous methylprednisolone is to be given, and I said it's in the selected patient, means definitely we have to give the IV methylprednisolone in any case of acute optic neuritis with abnormal MRI. Now, as we know that by ONTT trial, that IV methylprednisolone delays the onset of MS and also hastens the visual recovery. But this delays in the onset of MS we see in the first 2 years of the course of the disease, but on the long term, the patient in ONTT trial who were given the methylprednisolone and who were kept on the placebo treatment, the final visual outcome in both the group was the same. So like if you have a patient of acute optic neuritis where the visual acuity, where the MRI is normal, visual acuity is not very markedly deranged, it might be 6-9 or 6-6 sometime you can have in optic neuritis with the symptoms of, patient can come out with the symptom of color desaturation or contrast problem. In these cases, you can even withhold the treatment with steroid and keep on following the patient clinically. So we all know the dosing of methylprednisolone 1 gram per day for 3 days, followed by oral steroid for 11 days, with a tapering for 4 days. Okay. Now, decision, as I said, decision of giving the IV steroid, we have to make by considering the benefit and the risk of the therapy. We definitely use IV methylprednisolone in cases of acute optic neuritis where there is an MRI abnormal finding and the patient who present with severe bilateral visual loss. We have to keep it in mind that oral prednisolone is very strongly, it should not be given at all in these cases of optic neuritis, because in ONTT trial and other trial, it has been seen it increases the risk of recurrent attack of optic neuritis. And we know with the recurrent attack of optic neuritis, the visual outcome with every recurrence becomes quite poor. What is the terminology used for clinically isolated syndrome? The patient who has an optic neuritis only as a clinical manifestation of demyelinating disorder and with have an abnormal MRI, we label these cases either as a monosymptomatic disease or a clinical isolated syndrome. When we call these patients that they have converted to MS or now they turned into the cases of clinically definitive MS, when these patients either developed a demyelinating disorder manifesting in any other part of CNS or they develop on MRI a T2 hyperintense lesion in two or more in the number with 3 millimeter ellipsoid one, which are present in two out of four classic sites of MS. What are the classical sites of MS are? Either the justacortical site, periventricular, and brainstem and spinal cord. These are the four classical sites where MS lesion is mostly seen. And out of these four sites, if there are two lesions present, then we will say these are the abnormal MRI, and these patients are more likely to develop into the clinically definite MS. And we divide them, when we say that clinically isolated cases will develop definitely in clinically, now they have developed a clinically definite MS, depending on dissemination in the space and dissemination in the time. Dissemination in the space, I told you, when they represent the lesion present in the one of these classical sites, and when you follow these patients, they develop these classical features of MS on MRI in one of these other four sites, then you say that the patient had developed, now patient comes in the category of dissemination in time. Dissemination in space. Dissemination in time, when you do the MRI follow-up, and T2 enhancing lesion are present, and some of them, they are the gadolinium enhancing also, then you say this is the dissemination, the time. Now, the long-term management of these cases. We talked about, we all know that acute management of these cases is with IV methylprednisolone. Now, what about the long-term management of these cases? For the long-term management of cases of optic neuritis, which may be a clinically isolated with abnormal MRI, we treat these patients with immune modulator drugs or disease modifying therapy. And these are the interferon, beta 1A and beta 1B and glutaramate acetate. All these things, the three drugs, they have been in the use for last 10 to 15 years, and there are a lot of controlled randomized trial on them. And they are found to be very effective in long-term management of the cases of acute optic neuritis with abnormal MRI. Now, what about the cases with acute optic neuritis with normal baseline MRI? Because we know by ONTT trial, the patient who has an optic neuritis, which is a kind of a typical optic neuritis, a demyelinating type of optic neuritis, the presence of baseline normal MRI doesn't assure that the patient will not convert into the MS. Because out of that study of ONTT, 20% of the patient who had a normal baseline MRI at the time of acute optic neuritis episode went on developing the MS after a long period of 5 or 10 years. So these patients who had a normal MRI, baseline MRI, at the time of acute optic neuritis, we follow up these patients clinically in MRI, do MRI every 3 or 6 months according to the patient affordability. And if they are normal, then you repeat that at the end of 1 year. If all these three MRIs are normal, then there's no further need to follow these patients with MRI. unless the patient develops any new clinical symptoms. I mean to say new clinical symptom doesn't mean the patient developed the optic neuritis in the other eye. This will not call in dissemination the space. The patient should develop demyelinating symptomatology in any other part of the CNS. Now, what about the management of the cases who present with acute optic neuritis with baseline abnormal MRI? I told you what we mean by baseline normal MRI. Because in the case of optic neuritis, which may be a post-viral or paraviral or post-vaccinal one, there you may get white matter lesions, but they would not be at the classical site of MS and would not be fitting into the classical correct criteria or McDonald criteria. They have to be following the McDonald criteria, which I told you already, the 3 millimeter ellipsoid region, and two and more in the number, and two sites out of the four classical sites of MS, which are juxtacortical, paraventricular, brainstem, and the spinal cord. And the spinal cord should be in the cervical and thoracic area. These patients, we know that they have a 50% of the patient ONTT trial. They were found to be that they convert into the, they developed the clinically definitive MS after a period of 5 years. And as the period of follow-up increased 10 to 15 years, and out of 15 years, 70% of the patient, they could develop MS. So these are the patients should be treated with on the long term. They should be kept on the long term immunomodulated drugs. And now, as we know, by there are a lot of trials which were carried out using these immunomodulated drugs in the patient of acute optic neuritis with abnormal MRI findings. The meta-analysis of these trials, they showed that the patient who were given the treatment, where they show the less risk of developing conversion to clinically definite MS than the patient who were kept on placebo treatment. Now about the, we know these cases
can
of optic neuritis.
Just conclude your talk,
who
please.
Who have an abnormal MRI, they have a demyelinating episode somewhere in the CNS, they are definitely case of MS and should be treated acutely with IV methylprednisolone followed by immunomodulated drugs. Other, besides the interferon, other immunomodulated drugs are glatiramer acetate, and the clinical trial have been used for over the period of 15 years using these all the immunomodulators. They found to be very effective. And it is seen that initial treatment of these patients with these immunomodulatory therapy is much more effective in decreasing the recurrence, in the conversion to the MS, and in delaying the onset of new MRI lesions. This is another one, the new interferon drugs, which has been in the use from 19, which has been approved by FDA and has been in the use. And the advantages, other immunomodulators are used very frequently and injectable. And this is used injectably, but is a less frequent dose. And the newer anti-inflammatories, and natalizumab, which is used in the cases of acute optic neuritis, where there is a lot of MRI lesion and the disease is in very severe form. And fingolimide is not available in the country. The one side effects is the macular edema in these cases. And the advantage is it's an oral one. And these are the two which are available in the country, and both of them are used orally in the case of acute optic neuritis with abnormal MRI features.
Thank you, Dr. Komiddi. Please complete your
talk. Can I just one line?
1 second.
The acute optic neuritis, which is refractory to the management to IV methylprednisolone, we can try in these cases IV immunoglobulin and the plasma exchange therapy.
Thanks a lot. I think you have brought out the newer things which are happening in optic neuritis. We move on to the last talk, and that is by Dr. Rashmin Gandhi on the newer changes in anterior ischemic optic neuropathy management. So, Dr. Rashmin Gandhi.
Thank you very much. I would like to thank AIOS for having this national symposium for the first time, and would like to thank Dr. Pradeep Sharma for putting up such a nice program and involving me as a part of that program. So since we have less time, I'll just quickly rush through it so that we have some time for discussion. So in AION, let's just look directly to what's going on now. So there are three ways by which we treat any disease. Most of the time we like to treat disease on evidence-based. A lot of times we treat it from our experience. And the same disease where we might be quoting a paper to our patient, and if the same disease our uncle or aunt or our relative suffers, then there is an emotion which is involved and we might actually change our track, the way we treat our disease. And AIN is one of such diseases where we still don't know what's going on with, what is the main etiopathology, and that's the reason why all this confusion is going on. So let's look at what's the role of aspirin. Most of the time when we have a problem of ischemia in the body, we or a physician will start with aspirin. Though Anthony Arnold, who is considered as one of the world authority on NAION, he did a study and he found that there was no difference between treated and untreated group. People who received aspirin in NAION, there was no difference in either recurrence in the same eye or development of NAION in the other eye. In other words, aspirin doesn't seem to be a protective drug against NAION in the other eye, because that's what you are worried about. What about corticosteroids? There was a large study which was done by Sohan Singh Herrick. It was published in 2008. And if you look at the disease, if you look at the paper in isolation, you'll find that 69.8% of the eyes which were treated with steroids had improved vision versus 40.5% in an untreated group. A visual field improved in 40% versus 24.5% who did not receive corticosteroids. If you just look at this data, you'll find that corticosteroid has a major role to play in the treatment of NAION. But the problem with this study was that it was a patient choice study. So patient who had a grave disease of NAION, had a poorer vision, are also likely to have a very poor control of their vasculopathic risk factors, and they are likely to avoid taking steroids because steroid would further aggravate their problem of vasculopathic risk factors. So that's the reason why you may not be able to take this conclusion of Dr. Herre as a standard of care. There also has been a paper and a thought that a lot of these AIN people, patients have macular edema, and there's a possibility that patients who improve after developing AIN might be having macular edema, and once the fluid disappears, the vision improves. Data for intravitreal form of steroids or any other injections, including Avastin, erythropoietin, has been sparse. Can we do any surgery? Because it's believed that there is a compartment syndrome and there is a compression of the optic nerve because of collection of fluid. IONDT, which was conducted in the US, they tried doing optic nerve sheath fenestration for AIN, and they found that decompression surgery might be even harmful. I'll skip this in the interest of time. So what do we do? What's the role of steroids? Maybe you can give steroids, especially in somebody who comes to you within first 1 week of onset of the disease, has a very poor vision on presentation, or has a massive disc edema. Anything else which can be done? We need to make sure that the vasculopathic risk factors are taken care of. And these are some of the things which are coming up now. Sleep apnea seem to be associated with AIN, and so everybody who develops AIN should undergo sleep study. And if they are found to have sleep apnea, that should be treated. And probably we are reducing the risk of developing AIN in the other eye. In the male patients, we should avoid using erectile dysfunction drugs because that seem to cause a syndrome which is similar to NAION, and same with Emedron. Emedron has been associated with a syndrome which is similar to NAION. So these two, Emedron has to be replaced. And smoking obviously is injurious anyhow, and especially it is more damaging in somebody who has ischemia. So with that, I'll conclude so that we have some time for discussion. Thank you, sir.
Dr. Ashwin, I think with this we have the talks over. We will be having the questions, but before we start the questions, since this is a national symposium, we had a very grave national tragedy. We are all going to stand up for a minute and observe silence for the people who have lost their lives for our sake. Thank you all. Thanks, and we pray to God for peace for these souls who have departed for our sake. Now we can have the questions from belonging to any of the speakers. So whatever questions you have, please come forward. And this is the first time that we have had a national symposium on strabismus and neuro-ophthalmology. We have had it earlier with pediatric ophthalmology and strabismus, but with neuro-ophthalmology we have it first time. Yes, Dr. Jaspreet, yeah, come forward, yeah.
They were quite interesting talks. There was a very strong statement made by one of the speakers who said oral steroids are totally contraindicated in optic neuritis because they increase the recurrence. Now, what is the dose and how is that statement come? Because there are a lot of studies now coming up which say that in the acute stages, oral steroids given the dose of 500 milligram for 5 days are equivalent to IV methylpred. And that is the standard of care in UK, at least I know.
Yeah. So
no, but in the ONTT, it's very clearly said oral steroids per se are contraindicated because the chances of recurrences were seen more in the group in which oral steroids was given. So that comes from there.
So yeah. there are two things.
Yeah.
One is oral steroids should not be started. Number two, there is now this bioequivalence where if you give equivalent of 1 gram IVMP, then that should be, that is actually effective. And a lot of people are giving by. Yeah, 1,000 gram or so. One.
They're giving 500 milligram per day for 5 days.
Yes, that's and that,
yeah.
that actually
see.
Is coming.
500 methylpred.
Yeah, true.
Because basically we have to understand it's not an inflammatory condition. We are not giving anti-inflammatory doses. So that is the basic line that we have to understand.
No,
although we
right.
should wait for a little while because the very reason why they said it is contraindicated was recurrences, not efficacy.
Yeah.
So currently, based on 6 months and 1 year outcomes of the result, we are not sure about recurrences. So while bioequivalence for 1 year follow-up has shown equivalent outcomes with IVMP, let's wait for a little while before we categorically accept oral equivalent as a standard of care. So, of course, like I said, it is considered efficaciously equivalent, but then that was so for the standard oral therapy also. So, the downside was the recurrence, which we should wait for a bit.
Okay, any other questions?
And NMO is another condition I think we should keep in mind, though it's not that common, but there are differences between MS and NMO, and that those.
And you're right, and actually, NMO is very high in India.
Yeah.
The percentage of NMO population
so
in India is very
we need
high.
To, I think, yes. keep that in mind.
Yes,
yeah.
Question, please.
Please, on the mic. Is the mic on? Inka mic chal nahi raha. Boli Abdur.
Therapy for optic neuritis outside and not again the vision, not there is no improvement. And if the such
Hello.
Patient comes to us, then can we start this methylprednisolone? Because there are again
Sorry,
the.
Can you repeat your question? I just missed some of the
lines. Yeah, ma'am. Sure. Suppose patient having optic neuritis has taken treatment outside as a oral treatment, and as there is no improvement, patient has came to us. So can we start the IV therapy? And so guidelines for such patients, because I work in rural area, so these problems we do come across. Please highlight.
I think first 2 weeks of the onset of optic neuritis, it's very effective. Later on, if you give, it's not very effective. Already 2 weeks have passed, but I think giving the methylpred such a high dose, I don't think so.
Okay.
You can give antioxidant and other things, but it would not be. The first 2 weeks of onset of the disease, it's effective.
Okay, thank you, ma'am.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Yeah. My question is also to Dr. Kumudini, madam. Madam, if we have it's a optic neuritis, a clinical diagnosis. If we have a patient with severe visual loss, if you don't have an affordability for MRI, are you justified in starting methylprednisolone for that patient?
MRI is not a requirement for starting treatment. In fact, MRI is not even an essentiality. It is basically to find out the prognosis, so whether MS is there.
So based on the
you don't have to wait for MRI. You have to definitely wait for the diagnosis, whether it's a typical optic neuritis or atypical optic neuritis. Yes. So that can be done clinically.
And it is advantageous to start the patient on the steroid. Later on, you can do MRI, because whether it's typical or atypical, you have to give the steroid.
And second thing,
but in the typical, you have to give IV methylfred. But atypical, you can give oral steroid.
Yeah, but only thing is that if you have a risk of tuberculosis in your suspicion, do not give steroids.
And can we give one gram of methylprednisolone to all the adults, or should we vary it according to the weight?
We do all the adults. Adults.
For children, you have to do less. Yeah. Anyway, we thank all the panelists and all my speakers, and we give the stage to the next symposium. Thank you all.